Howdy Tubers, welcome back to the Zach Life. So if you're wondering what all this junk is here on my table, this is going to be most of the stuff that I'm going to use to control the steerable axle on my golf cart suburban crawler hauler trailer. Now if you're new around here, this trailer is a companion build to a motorhome of mine. It's a 359 Peterbilt toter home, and it's got a heavy haul steer axle. It does not turn very well at all, and I was a little bit concerned about getting in a bind, like in the back of an RV park or something, with a long trailer. And so I built a trailer as short as I could, stand the rock crawler up, haul a suburban, and I wanted it to have a steerable axle, so if you get back in a tight spot, you can actually use the trailer to help you manipulate yourself around. And anyway, this video is probably going to be kind of long. It's going to be more on the technical side. It's going to have a lot to do with machining, talk about press fits, tapers, cutting threads. I'd like to not skip anything for, you know, a few reasons, but mostly because I tried to think about how to do this, and it took me a while to come up with some of this stuff, and I hope it works, but I wanted to show in great detail exactly how I do every step. Quick overview of kind of what I'm going to do. This is actually a pneumatic cylinder that's designed to go on a steer axle. It is in junkyard state. I'm hoping it's rebuildable. We'll find out about that. I don't have any idea. I may have to do something else, but it's mine. It was free. And then anyway, the other part, I've got to have a system to lock the axle to keep it from being able to steer, you know, straight. You know, you need to be able to lock it straight ahead. And I thought about all different kinds of tapered pins and, you know, pneumatically controlled whatevers. And what I'm going to do, obviously this will be explained a lot more in the rest of the video, but basic overview, I'm going to take a piece of shaft and cut an eccentric out of it and have that eccentric pivot around and sort of lock in to a notch that I'm going to cut. It's going to have this piece of pipe with this piece of round bar slid in here with a notch cut out of this, and the eccentric is going to turn and lock into a radiused out part, if you would, and then it's going to be controlled by this air chamber. If you're not familiar with these, the spring brake side actually applies with a spring, and so it'll be applied all the time unless there's air applied to this, and applying air to the brake chamber will release the axle. That's enough about that. We'll get into all the details and whatever. Fix to go up to my machine shop, my wannabe machine shop, and start doing some machining. I'll explain what's going on when we get there. The first thing I'm going to do is face this piece of tubing. This is probably mostly aesthetic, but I want to get a good clean face on this piece of pipe. Now this is going to be the piece of pipe. It's going to be obscure and hard to explain what all these pieces do. It'll all come together at the end. This is going to be the piece that's actually welded to the frame. I have a notch cut out of it. And the steering part will actually slide through it, one end to the other. Thank you.
So this is going to be the piece that slides in this. I want it fairly snug, but the problem is when I weld on this, this is liable to warp. And so I'm contemplating how much slack to leave it. Now, one thing I can do is I can always pull this back out and bring it back up here and turn it smaller, but I'd rather do it all at one whack. I've only got 60 thousandths difference in this measurement and this measurement. This was supposed to be DOM tubing. It is not. I think that it might be some kind of seamless, but it's got some die marks in it. It's definitely not that round and that precise. It's also got some rust and it's been laying outside. But anyway, I've got to get this running pretty precise before I center it, because if it's off 100 thousandths, when I turn it to size, it won't clean up on one side. And the easiest way to do that is put the machine in neutral. And I'll just come in here with a tool by eye and try to get it running reasonably close. Kind of check in the middle, make sure it's reasonably straight. Now then, that drills a taper that this thing fits in the center. Almost, not quite. Two-speed tailstock. While it's cutting, I want to show you my old welding machine. Still runs in wells. Or did. Well, never mind. Lincoln Bullet. So I've got these two pieces. These are going to be the bearing, for lack of a better word, for the eccentric. And I want to chuck these up, face the fronts, make them the same length, and then run a boring bar through them, just to give a nice round, defined ID. Alright, so what I'm fixing to attempt here is not very kosher, but it's what I'm gonna try to do. So this is going to be my eccentric. And what I plan on doing here is to take and put this in the chuck, and then take a spacer and put under one of the jaws in this chuck to have this thing chuck really out of whack. See if I can move that one back there. Something like that. Now this obviously is not going to run straight. It's going to do this, but I want to make sure it's not doing this. I want this to be parallel with the bed, even though it's running out of square. If I don't, the shaft in the center of my eccentric won't be straight. Now this doesn't, there's no reason for this to be perfect, but I'd like it for it to be reasonably close. And we can check this by just running a tool back and forth here and eyeballing the distance. It's actually getting wider down here, so I need to tap it towards the tool. Looks pretty good. That didn't work, did it? Golly. Hope this isn't too much. Yeah, that looks decent. All right, now then, I got my center in here so that the chuck is not holding all this stress out here. This should be safe to cut and get as rough as you'd like with. The problem with doing this is there's no way you could ever put it back in the chuck and get it in the right place. I guess maybe if you marked where the chuck was, it would be, you know, relatively close. But anyway, I'm going to start whittling on this. Basically this collar is going to go here, and the eccentric needs to be up here. I want to kind of scoot everything up. I can cut this off later, and I plan on doing that. I'm going to use the compound to try to get where I don't have sharp edges. Also, this probably is not going to actually clean completely up. The high side will, you know, will probably not quite be round. I want this to be at least 1.25 inches, as big as possible, just for strength. But I'm going to use the side of the eccentric to engage. So as long as I get it cleaned up back to about here, we should be good. I don't know how long my battery's going to last. I want to start whittling on this. If it dies, you'll have a pretty good idea what I'm doing. We'll be back tomorrow. Let's do it. Thank you. All right, the next day, I run out of battery last night, and I ran out of me. I got you tied on the cross slide here. Maybe this will make a little better video. So I got this done. I just need to put this back in the chuck the right way. I got a little bit of change of plan. I want to leave this the size it is. I'm going to chuck these back up and bore these to fit this instead of the other way around.
So we're back here at Mother Shop. I'm not exactly sure how clear I've made how this is going to work. I'm going to try to give a very basic demonstration. I guess this is probably dumb. It'd be best just to wait till y'all get to see it all put together. So we've got this will be mounted to the frame. This will be what actually moves back and forth with the steering. So what I'm going to do is bore, or whatever you would call with a boring bar, I guess bore, I'm not really making a hole, but a notch through this piece of tubing and into this piece of rod. And then this will fit down in there. These two pieces will be attached to here, and you'll be able to rotate this eccentric, and it will lock in to the notch that's cut in this piece of round bar. The next thing I need to do is I'm going to pull this out, bolt this down to the bed, and notch out this piece that'll actually clear this like 1-800 piece of shaft. But the first thing I got to do is get this old machine ready to run. This thing hasn't moved in probably a couple of years, and it needs some oil and a few attention, a little bit of attention. It's kind of neat. I'm going to show you around it.
All right, so like I say, this old machine's been sitting dormant for probably more than a couple of years. It's kind of a shame how poorly I've taken care of it. It's got some surface rust and stuff built up on it. But, you know, sometimes that's how that stuff goes. It's everything in my shop seems to rust. It's definitely not like deep penetrated rust, but it makes the surface rust. Anyway, it's got several spots here. This thing needs oil. This is a Brown and Sharp. What was the number 2? I think the date on this is probably between about 1908 and 1915. I don't know exactly. It doesn't actually have a serial number on it. I think that this oil's the gear mechanisms in here that gives you the different ratios for the feed speed. So one of the things about this whole machine that's so neat is that it's mechanically power feed in all directions, up, down, in and out, and side to side. And it's pretty unusual, especially today. kind of neat. It's got all these little oil holes. I don't have three-phase here in my shop at my house, so I got an electric motor they're running as a phase converter. It's not the greatest deal, but it's just enough. The machine will just start. These are the actual main bearings of the machine. All right, so how this machine works, you know, this was not factory. Now there's levers on the other side. I've got four gear ratios inside this gearbox. Initially, this wouldn't have been here. This is aftermarket. It would run off a line shaft. So you'd have a shaft that went through your top of your shop with leather belts. It came off your shaft, and the shaft would have been run either by steam or, you know, possibly a stationary engine. You know, later on, probably 1900, it would have been steam. And anyway, you've got four different speeds. This would be the lowest, and faster and faster and faster, and you would move the belt left to right to change your initial speed of this drum. The other thing, so how do I explain this the easiest? So you've got this little deal here. This is a lock, and so this is basically would be in high range. So for every revolution of the drum, you've got four speeds. For every revolution of the drum, the spindle turns one revolution. To put this in low range, you would disconnect this lock, and now the spindle turns free of this drum, if that's the right word, and you can engage this gear, and now the spindle turns one revolution for every two revolutions of the drum, or whatever, the pulley, whatever you would call this. Of course, I want to go fast. We're using carbide now. We don't have to deal with high speed steel or whatever they did back in the day. We'll kick this out, and then turn the drum until this little keeper here locks into a lock somewhere right there. So that will be its fastest speed. And of course, probably with what we're doing, we want to go about as fast as we can. I may slow this down. Let's see what gear we're in here. We are actually in fourth. Let's go back to third. So we'll crank it up. Now this here is a little bit confusing to me, but this is how you set your feed rates per revolution. Three thousandths to 150 thousandths. And so you'll move this, maybe. I'm not gonna fight this because it's probably where I want it to be, and I remember this kind of being a pain. But you've got four like ranges here that you'll move these gears, or these levers, into different gears. So this would be, you know, 9000ths. This would be 7000ths. If you moved it one over, it'd be 6000ths, 5, 4, 3. And anyway, then you move this lever down, and that engages this drive shaft. This is a reverser box. So as you can see, this has got this gear, and there's other shafts and stuff inside here turning one direction. If you flip this to the other way, it will go the other direction. This lever engages up and down. Right now it's going down. See, it's so greasy, it's not even moving smooth. Of course, if we flip this and kick it going up, it'll go up smoothly. I don't know if you can see it moving. This lever makes it go in. Obviously, if you flip this to this little box back here to reverse, then it would make it go out. and then this controls either left or right, and you could actually control both directions left and right with the table without having to switch the little reverser deal. All right, this isn't gonna be a very glamorous machine job. I don't know exactly what that boring bar is set to as far as how big a hole it's gonna bore. I was looking at it as it was running. It looked like it was probably a 2-inch, you know, circle it was drawing. This is not precise. It doesn't matter. The only thing I've got to do is hog a hole out to where that cam thing we made or eccentric will clear and go into it. And so I'm not gonna worry about it. I'm just gonna run it. Let's start machining. So what I'm looking for, and I know this probably is probably hard to grasp, but I want this hole just deep enough that when I lay this in it, with this in the highest position, that the rod will just clear, you know, or almost touch the center right here, so that when we turn it, it'll have the highest mechanical advantage. All right, here we go. Let me tack this together and I'll sort of show it to you after I get it tacked up. The next thing I need to do, this needs just a very, very mild flat spot in it, very short, probably 100 thousandths would be plenty. I'm gonna go mill a flat spot in this. We can slip it together, and then I need to bore a notch sort of like this one in here that'll accept this round part of this crank thingy. Okay, luckily that last operation didn't have to be precise because it wasn't. Anyway, I got it set up in this machine. I've got to bore the hole out. It goes roughly right here. It's just laying a tape measure across this thing to, you know, to roughly center it. It's only going to go down in there like 300 thousandths, and I want the hole to fit this relatively close. I don't want it to be smaller than this. I don't want it to be able to wedge in there, but I want it with at least within maybe 5 thousandths or something, so that there won't be any slack in it. I've got this boring head's probably set up about 1 inch. I'm just gonna start with it, and when we get closer, we'll start measuring it, fitting it, and moving everything, and get it as precise as we can. Okay, so here it is. There's the magical notch. When you twist this is what will lock this together. So I gotta go make some more parts. The first thing I'm gonna do, I've got a piece of this, I've cut off the ring, it's still kinda hot, I chop sawed it. I gotta bore it out to fit this shaft here, and then clean the end of it up, give it a flat face, and it'll sit up against this collar, and that's what'll keep this centered. As long as this rod's in there, of course it won't be removable once it's put on there, this can't come out, but the weight of this collar sitting against this collar is what will act like a thrust bearing, if you would, to keep it centered. I'm going to chop saw this piece off. So I kind of goofed, and I got to backtrack and get some stuff kind of figured out. I learned something important to my fellow YouTubers. The Lumix camera that you're watching me on right now takes an SD card. My GoPro takes a micro SD card. And I have got this little deal that plugs in my MacBook that takes all the different kinds of flash memory. I don't know. It's got a couple of wide slots. I don't know. It's got about 5 or 6 slots. But it's got a micro SD card slot and a regular SD card slot. And anyway, I was in there last night before last. I downloaded the SD card, and then I plugged the micro SD card in it to download the information off the micro SD card that was at off the GoPro that I used up there at the machine shop. And apparently, you can't plug both cards in at the same time, even though I didn't really think that would probably work. I didn't think it'd be a problem. And I actually was wondering, I thought it might pop up as two different drives on my MacBook, but it didn't. It immediately wiped both of those cards. Like they were not, I guess formatted is a word. Like I had to go in there and format them to make them work again. Like it wouldn't even recognize them. I don't know, it's like I don't understand. Like it just zapped them or something. Like they were just completely blank. The MacBook wouldn't even, like it would see it in Disk Utilities, but it wouldn't even pop up on the desktop dashboard. It wouldn't pop up on the desktop. Anyway, luckily I'd already got all the information off the camera you're watching me on now, but I lost all the video that I had on the GoPro that I had up there at my machine shop. And I use that word loosely. Anyway, I've got the video from here, but I don't have the video making it. And the next thing I've got to do, which is already finished, done, and installed, is I've got to make the piece that's going to attach the Heim joint to the pitman arm on the axle. And so I think I can make all this make sense. Let me cut to that. We'll get that installed, and then we'll come back to this exact next instant, and we'll talk about the rest of this. So I'm going to use 3/4-inch Heim joints to connect from this to the axle. One important thing is I guess one of many important things, but the place that the drag link connects is a taper, like a ball joint taper. And I've got to figure out what the taper is, and I've got to cut a correct taper to fit up in that. And I'll show you in a minute, but I don't want to have to drag the camera over there. I'll show you when we come back. But anyway, I've got to make a piece that'll fit up in that taper with a threaded bolt that'll pull tight in the taper, and then will be a also press fit to this Heim joint, where the Heim joint will go on the bottom of it with a nut that goes on the bottom of the Heim joint. I want all this to be, you know, relatively precise. Everything needs to be within a thousandth or so. I want this to be a, you know, half thousandth press fit, and the taper's got to be exactly correct. If it's not, it will work and waller the hole out, and that's not an option. Anyway, sometimes figuring out tapers is problematic, especially short ones like this. And so I measured it the best I could. It's hard to measure, you know, the largest point of a conical hole. It just is difficult. Anyway, the small side was like 921 thousandths. The big side was 1 inch, 94 thousandths, and it was 1.339 tall. And that comes out to 1.55 inches per foot of taper. Now, I'm going to guess that they probably didn't use a weird number like that. It's probably supposed to be 1.5 inches per foot of taper. And so I'm going to take this piece of hot roll, go set the machine up to cut 1.5 inches taper per foot, and then just cut a taper, and we'll bring it back here and fit it and see how it fits and what it feels like. You can tell if you've got a taper correct by the way it fits in a hole. If it's off, it'll have slack and you can feel it. If it's really close, you'll be able to pop it in and it'll stay in like you got to take a hammer to knock it out. Let's run up there and knock this stuff out. All right, so I think this is actually going to work. It fits really nicely. You know, you can push it in there and it stays. No,
There's no slack you can feel or anything. So I'm gonna take a Sharpie and mark the top. And the bottom, we're gonna need that just a minute. Let's go finish this thing. All right, I ran out of camera up there at my machine shop. But anyway, I cut a counter bore in this thing because you can't really cut threads all the way up flat against the shoulder. You know, I got pretty close here. But this lets this nut go all the way up against that face. And this face should be very close to flush with the top of this when we install it. And it is. It's just... probably can't see it just right underneath there. Alright, there's that part. Okay, this is going to be, as we measure, this is 1,000th press. Being this small, it's going to be relatively tight. And what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to heat this thing up. Now, this is full of plastic. If you get this more than, you know, probably 200-300 degrees, it would melt. If you could get it to 400-500 degrees, you could just slip it right on there. I'm gonna warm this up and see if this will help us get it on there at all. Be a negative. Some anti-seize would probably been quite beneficial. It's too late now. Move any? Really not all that tight. There's just not a good way to hit it. There it is. So the next thing I've done is I've cut out this little piece of 2 7/8 tubing, and it's going to go over this sort of like that. I'm going to weld all this out. This is going to be a structural piece to help attach this piece to these pieces, but also it's going to be just a cover to keep dirt and stuff out of this. And I plan on putting a grease cert in this cover, and you'll be able just to fill this cavern up with grease. And it should squirt grease out all the different ways on this thing. Keep it well lubricated. I'm gonna weld this out real quick. After that, I'm a little bit confused about what I've shown you and what I hadn't shown you because I lost all that video. But I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna put a bead, you know, here and here. I'm gonna take this back up to my machine shop, chuck up on this thing, and cut this weld back flat to give me sort of a thrust surface, if you would. Okay, welcome back. That was 1 second for me. So here's all these pieces. Let me zoom you in a little bit here. So this stuff is all done. So I have got there's a greaser drilled and tapped here. There's one in this piece, and there's one in the bottom of this piece. So how this is going to all go together like this. Just like this. And so you'll basically twist this thing and it locks into this. This piece has got this little thing ring welded on it. It's like a positive stop. It stops it. This part, there'll be two of them, go here and there, and this is actually a machine to take a seal. I got a seal while driving this when it's finished. This obviously goes on the bottom. This will be welded to the frame, and then the rod, which will come in from the other side, will go in and out and is connected to the pitman arm. I've taken this, and this has been drilled and threaded, bored and threaded for 3/4 inch fine thread, which is the same thread as a heim joint that we installed a few days ago that you just watched a few seconds ago. Hello? All right, I hope you can see me, because I can't really see you. So anyway, this piece here threads on to this heim joint, and there'll be a jam nut, but I'm not going to put the jam nut on it yet. Okay, so basically what I've got to do is get in here and weld this against this here, and then this thing will pivot as this comes in and out. Now, for those of you with keen eyes, you'll see a big problem here, and this is hopefully not a problem, and that is this has got to be perfectly perpendicular to the axis of the kingpin, because if this is running uphill to the kingpin, it thinks kind of hard to pick up, it's heavy. When you swing the axle, when this tries to go in and out, it's going to want to twist this direction. It's going to bind up. This needs to, God dang, hit my elbow. This thing has got to be in the right plane where it's going to bind up. I'm not going to video this because I'm probably going to tack this a bunch of times and then just work it back and forth to check it. I'm thinking that I can leave a little bit of slack between these two mating surfaces of the thrust, where it can actually go up and down a little bit to probably take up a little bit of that. I want it to be correct, but as far as having a little bit of room where if something flexes or moves, it'll be able to flex. Now this here is all good steel, and so if anything actually gets in a bind, it's simply going to flex this big rod or the pitman arm. But if it's in a big bind, it's not going to be able to work. So I want it. It's got to work. That's the point. All right, I got this welded in a position I think will work. I'm going to do the final assembly. I went up there and cut off a nut, made me a jam nut for the heim joint here. All right, first thing is this. I'm going to go ahead and smear a little bit of grease on all these components, even though I've got grease certs. Off that noisy welder. Now, about screwing this in or out will be how you set the center of the wheels. By screwing this in and out is the adjustment of where the wheels center. So this seems to work pretty well. This rod actually hits, you can't see it, it hits this bearing part of the big hinge thing, but it's a good solid stop. It won't hurt anything. It binds just a little bit when you go all the way out, but I'm still able to move it. And it's also a little bit too far down. And what I'm thinking is when you weight this thing, the axle will flex a little bit. So I think that this will actually come up in relation to that. And this thing's got about 1/4 inch. This thing can actually come up. And so hopefully that'll take up any flex or anything in it. It's actually, now that I've wiped it back and forth. It's almost completely free. Anyway, the next thing, I got to build the little arm, mount the air biscuit, and dry the seal in here, but I think that that's going to be all for tonight. Catch y'all in the morning. So the brake can has got a force of 1,800 pounds. It's pushing on the little bracket on the eccentric here. It's 4 inches, and the actual eccentric is 5/8 of an inch off center of the center shaft. So we have 1,800 multiplied by 4 divided by 5/8 gives us 11,500 pounds that the eccentric is pushing in on that shaft. Now that's not the force it's going to take to move the shaft. That's going to be much higher. It's just giving us 11,500 pounds of force pushing in on that shaft. I think that it would destroy everything here before the shaft could actually push and cam back that 11,500 pounds. I don't think that any of this device here would probably be strong enough. I think it would split the pipe or anything else before you could push hard enough on that rod in this mechanism to actually push that cam back out with that much force. So I didn't get the air cylinder fixed or put on there. There's still quite a bit left to do with the plumbing and the control system, all this. But this has been like 3 weeks that I've been working on this to where we're at. You know, the 2 weeks previous, I didn't have a video out because I've been jacking with this. I've been really busy, hadn't been able to work on it a lot. It's been really nice weather, so that's a good opportunity for me to try to make money. And that's what I've been doing. We'll probably get some rain, get cold, and I'll be able to start working back on some of this stuff next week. But it's been 3 weeks. I want to get y'all a video out. I'm going to kind of abruptly end this. I'm not sure how well y'all could tell in the last clip of that. This brake chamber is a standard, the part number is a 3030 brake chamber. And it's supposed to be a 2.5 inch stroke. And I actually put a tape measure on that. I was, you know, measuring if I put it on there. It actually was only about a 2.25 inch stroke. And about 2.25 inches is how much stroke I needed to make this mechanism work. And basically, that brake chamber doesn't have enough stroke to completely back that cam thing up enough to allow the wheels to move. Now, this is easily fixed. You just get a 30-30 long stroke, and it's got an extra 1/2 inch of stroke. And so I'll pick one of those up for the next video. And then we'll get the air cylinder fixed. I got the stuff already in to pack the cylinder and fix it all. It looked really good. It's just I didn't have time to get it done. This is the 30th. I'm going to try to get this out for y'all. Happy New Year's, by the way. When y'all are watching this, will be New Year's Day, I guess. And anyway, like I said, kind of hate to abruptly end this. I just kind of run into a wall here, and I got to get y'all a video out. So that's what I'm going to do. Appreciate you watching. Like, share, subscribe, all the good stuff, and catch you on the next one.